Hey everybody, this is Sheets, and we're going to be going over the UFC 304 card, and we're going to be dedicating this video completely to lineup construction. Specifically, how to construct a portfolio of lineups to attempt to win the 200,000 in the MMA DFS, like kind of like lottery tournament with thousands and thousands of people in it. So as I mentioned in the breakdown of the fights on Thursday. This is it's a very welcome 14 fight card. And I say welcome because when you have a 14 fight card, you don't have to get as crazy with your lineup construction as you do when you have an 11 or 12 fight card when you're trying to, maximize the amount of money you're going to make, because the big balancing act that you always have to try to perform in DFS is trying to figure out what lineups you want to play that have a chance to win, but that not that many people are going to be playing, because you don't want to be chopping it up with too many players and too many entries. And when you get to 11 or 12 fights in MMA, it becomes very, very difficult to get unique without really making a lot of sacrifices to the upside and ability of your lineups to actually get there. Now, when you get to a 14 fight card, it becomes a little more, I don't say easy, but the convergence between the lineups that you want to play and the lineups that can pay a lot is a little bit better. Like, you don't have to leave 4,000 on the table throughout all of your lineup. You don't have to do all kinds of funny business with your ownership to make it work. Now, again, it's still, you still have to, be somewhat cognizant of it. You can't play the 20 lineups that are most likely to be the optimal, because they are going to be pretty highly duped. But there are a lot of combinations that do have a chance to win that are going to maybe be unique or even under five dupes or things like that. So you don't have to set your settings too wildly. So let's talk about that, okay? And so the first thing that I did was I uploaded projections and I ran 5,000 lineups in SaberSim. Okay. I used the default lineups. I built 5,000 just so that we have, again, a pool of lineups to choose from. And all this comes down to after that is how to rank these things. Like, which 150 of these 5,000 am I gonna play? Okay. And that's really all that this is really all that this is about. So how do we rank these things? Well, let's remind ourselves of the different levels of aggression that you can play. Let's actually go from the most conservative to the most aggressive. So first of all, the most conservative, I guess, is if you just rate all these by projected score, and that's definitely something you don't want to do. Okay, now it's really funny when you rate these by top projected score, you actually get an Ardeline in the top projected score. But again, we're not trying to get the top projected score. We're trying to get the lineup with the most upside, right? That might not be quite as owned, that they can actually have a chance to win the whole thing. But when you look at this, like, under projected score, that's all this is it rate these lineups by projected median outcomes. Okay. Now, let's go to the next, I guess, most conservative. I guess the best way to describe this is the Saber Score Sim Diversity 10. This is the next thing I want to look at. So this is actually on the aggressive side, certainly more aggressive than projected score. And what we can do, again, is look into where these kind of formulas come from. Like, what does this ranking mean? So we click on the eyeball, it says, so the formula to rank these is 100 times the sim optimal plus 0.8 times the sum of the projection, which is kind of reasonable. And then they would subtract 0.2 times the average adjusted ownership. So it is dinging lineups for being too highly owned. And it's rewarding them for being part of these simulated optimal builds. Okay, so that is, that's not bad. I mean, that's pretty representative, a decent kind of upside portfolio of lineups. Okay. Now, normally in a, like in a 10 or 11 fight card, you want very little part of these lineups because they're going to be very, very highly duped. And they just are. But on a 14 fight card, this actually has a chance. Okay. Like at least some of these lineups like have a chance to win and be unique and things like that. So while normally we would kind of, I don't want to say dismiss, but kind of de-emphasize this build, we're going to probably use more of this than usual. The next highest level of, I guess, of aggression has got to be the one that is created by the Sims. So let's actually, let's run that. I didn't run that yet. So let's hold on. Let's actually put my lineups in here. And let's right click this and we'll put I don't know why I didn't do this beforehand. Sorry about this. We'll add contest sim and this is the flagship MME. All right, so we'll just use the flagship MME setting and let's run this contest sim. Oops, I don't want to do that. Let's just run the sims here. And so now what we're doing is taking this 5,000, these 5,000 lineups and comparing them to the field of lineups that Saber Sims backtesting feels is the best representation of what the field is going to do. Okay. So the idea behind this is to try to tailor our lineup specifically to the tournament that we're playing. Okay. Like for example, if you look at it, it'll also show you. 35,294 people, this amount to first, et cetera. Now, if you want to click through this, by the way, you could see, what that field kind of represents, but that's not the purposes of this, but you can do that if you want. And now what we'll do is we'll rank these by this sim and by risk adjusted ROI. Okay. So what we have now, okay, is kind of the top 150 lineups that have been determined by running the sims against the field of lineup that Saber Sim kind of defaults to. So this set of lineups is definitely more aggressive than the sim diversity 10 lineups, okay, because they've at least taken into account what they think everybody else is going to do and kind of try to fade against that a little bit. Okay. Again, we're not even looking at who we have. We don't even care. And this is not rating them in order. So who we have is not even remotely relevant to this process. Okay. We're trying to figure out, we're trying to dismiss like who these fighters are. We're trying to just look at them as just kind of inputs, you know what I mean, on a spreadsheet because we've already factored in who we think were best plays when we did the projections, right? So we can't then go and say, well, I don't care what my process gives me because I'd rather have this fighter. We've already accounted for what fighter we think is a good play by adjusting our projections properly. So this is the next set. Now, if you want to get up to the highest level of aggression, that which is going to be very likely to get you a lot of unique lineups, is then you go into this thing that's called MMA default again. Now, forgive me if you've seen me go through this before. An MMA default is just about the most aggressive thing that there is, and to prove that, you can look at, you look at the eyeball here, and it'll show you the formula, and it's not just the sim optimals. It's 0.5 times the sum of the projections, but then it's what it's doing is it's multiplying half of the 99th percentile outcome of the lineup, okay, and that is super duper aggressive. It means that we don't care, give an F about the median and how the lineup does on a median basis. We're saying how this lineup does on the outliers, okay? And that is just about as aggressive as you can do, okay? And then you also are subtracting 0.3 times the sum of adjusted ownership. So this is as aggressive as you can get. Now, if you didn't like this, you could change this metric to be a little less aggressive, and like I've done this with this sheets default setting, which I create on my own, and what that is, and we'll go through this what this means. We'll look at the formula here, and this is the same. It's 0.5 times some of the projection plus 0.5 times the 95th percentile outcome. Okay, so it's a little less outlierish, right? It's still pretty outlierish, but not completely outlierish. So I would consider this kind of the next of the more aggressive ones, right? So you're going to have at the one end, you're going to have the projected score. We don't want that. Then we're going to want some amount of the sabers, the sim optimal tens, or what do you call it? The not sim optimal tens, what are they called? The sim diversity tens. We're going to have some of the ones that are from the sims. We're going to have some of the MMA defaults and some of the cheats defaults. Now, what that does not do, again, is it does not manage portfolio, right? Like one set of lineups doesn't know what the other one is doing. So you could, after all of this, you can kind of manually kind of adjust that if you want. The other thing that you might want to consider in some slates is a tactful salary restriction, meaning that if you want to get somewhat different, you're going to want to maybe leave some money on the table on purpose. Now, one technique which I've discussed quite a bit is if you like a kind of a very popular underdog, specifically kind of a smaller underdog, one thing you can do is leave money on the table such that you would get the fighter's opponent, okay, in the optimals, okay, unless you left the money on the table. So like for example, let's again, I've been through this before, but for those of you here for the first time, I'm sorry about this, but I mean, let's just say that you liked, where's the Gregory Rodriguez fight? Because that's a good example. Where's Rodriguez? Gregory Rodriguez is 7,900, and he's fighting $8,300 Christian Leroy Duncan. And you like Rodriguez, but you think he's going to be popular, right? Just for example, what you could do is take Gregory Rodriguez lineups and leave 400 on the table. The idea being that the optimals and the optimizers might get tricked. The optimizers, if there's 8,300 left, they might give those slots to Duncan. So we could end up getting Rodriguez in a slightly less popular lineup builds. Okay, by playing Rodriguez and leaving the 400 on the table, just daring everybody else to use that 400 to play, the probably the higher median projected fighter. Okay. But the larger the field, like the larger the slate, the less you need to do that kind of funny business. Okay. Now, with that said, I do think that leaving 400 on the table is not the end of the world. I think that's actually not a bad idea. One of the reasons for that is because again, you have, Nathaniel Wood, 9,400, who might not even be better than a 9K, one of the 9K fighters below him. So it's not a bad idea to leave some money on the table. Like for example, let's take Nathaniel Wood for example. Like definitely Sam Patterson has more upside than him, so you should at least leave 200 on the table. But then again, you're not really gaining much because Sam Patterson is going to have a higher median projection than Nathaniel Wood anyway. So even if you did leave the 200 on the table, you're really not getting anywhere. And I don't think at this point in the cycle, people are making a rule saying you must have 49.8 or something like that. You have to get to that point where people are not going to want to intentionally, that people are going to fear leaving that money on the table. Let's put it that way. So I don't think it's the worst idea in the world to leave 400 on the table in all lineups that are not, MMA defaults or sheets defaults. Okay. If you're running your least conservative or your most conservative builds, like Sim Diversity 10 or the Sims, then all of those, I don't think it's a bad idea to leave 400 on the table. Okay. So the way we would do that, so again, this is not difficult. Let's take a look again at at these. We're going to filter these. These are the sim lineups. And let's just go by filter. Filter, add filter. Salary less than 4,000, 49,700. That's why we're leaving at least 400 on the table. So we'll save these. And so these are gonna we're gonna make sure that these are the ones that that make it. Okay. The other thing you could do, which I don't think I'm going to, is you could do geo mean filtering. And what that does is it attempts to predict the amount of dupes that you're going to be facing by just suggesting that if you know the product of ownership of a certain lineup, that you could at least guesstimate how often that lineup is going to be duped. That technique for MMA is a little bit fishy. It ends up just by really just jamming in like too much of the lowest of the lowest owned fighter. And the other thing I would say is that I don't think that you want to mix and match, or you don't want to combine techniques. Like, I don't think you need to leave money on the table and do geo mean filtering. I think you do geo mean filtering if you didn't leave money on the table. But I don't think geo mean filtering really matters too much in MMA because you have this other setting that you can play with, like the MMA default setting and the sheets default setting that already just gives you just that 99th percentile outcome, which I think is good enough, you know? So I would rather have the 95th percentile outcome than just a low-owned fighter, you know what I mean, that may or may not ever get there, you know? So this is the question of now, how much do you want to do of each one? And then that's really your choice. I believe that on a 14 fight card like this, where the ownership I don't think is that crazy. In other words, I don't know if anybody's going to be that popular. I've seen projected ownerships of like Aspinall be like 45, 46%, but I don't know. I mean, there's 28 fighters, a lot of upside on this card. Well, I don't know about that. So I wouldn't worry. Well, so on the one hand, I wouldn't worry too much about ownership. On the other hand, if they really think Aspinall is going to be 47%, I think you could, whatever it takes to get different from that, I think you should probably try. So again, I could just build these things. So let's just, you want to just build some? Let's take a look. And the one way to do it is you put clear favorites. This is one way to play this. And just start adding them until you get the 150, I guess, that aren't duplicated. So like let's start with these. Let's start with, I guess, I don't know, 30 lineups from the Sims that are leaving 400 on the table. Now, question, do we want to require it to be min uniques of more than one? I think that's healthy. I think that's healthy to get a little more variance, especially in these types of settings. Okay. So we'll go min uniques 2, for example, and then we'll add these 30 to the favorites. I'm going to do it. Okay. And then we'll take the filter off for a second, and we'll go back to Sim Diversity 10. And let's actually, you know what? Let's add that filter back, sir. That 400 salary less than 400 49,700. All right, so this is another 30. And these are like kind of conservative, but we're leaving 400 on the table, right? So we'll save these. Let's just see. So it added, you'll see that it went from 30 to 58. Why is that? Because two of the lineups were already accounted for in the sim version. Okay. So you don't want to have them duped. You don't want to dupe yourself, you know, for openers. So then what you can consider is some amount of the MMA default setting or the sheets default setting. So let's get rid of this filter because we don't need that for those. And let's go back into, say, I don't know, MMA default. Okay, we'll do min uniques too. And if you want, we could get pretty aggressive here. You know, we can get pretty aggressive. We could go 40 lineups from MMA default. Add those, boom. And then we can go to sheets default. And we'll add 40 of those. Having it add. So now we have 123 lineups. And now it's just a question of what you want to do with the other 27. And I've heard like a lot of different ways to handle this. I forget who it was that mentioned this to me, but how bad is it to build 27 lineups of just your favorite plays? I mean, it's probably pretty bad, right? I mean, your favorite plays are just going to be naturally duped, but just to kind of balance out your risk a little bit, because you know, I've already gotten pretty aggressive with at least half my lineups, and if not, maybe more because of the money I left on the table. So what I might do is for the 20 other 27 lineups, I'll just pick kind of my favorite plays and just kind of like mix and match them. Like for example, I mean, I don't know. Let's say we'll take out we'll only use the guys that we want. So it's going to be Parsons. I like Parsons. Like Patterson. I like Blades. I like Muhammad. I like Mikhaev. I don't like Edwards. Don't like Hadley. I like Lofgren. I like Patty Pimblett. Don't like Bukauskas or Allen or Kopp or Pineda or Chaji or Giga. Sorry. I like Aspinall. I don't like Bobby Green. I like Greg Rodriguez. Don't really like Alice XX. And we like Christian Leroy Duncan. We'll apply this. And obviously, this is not going to work, but let's build another, like, say, 27 lineups with these, with all these combinations. So let's just see. We don't need to build, you know, we don't need to build that many. I bet you there aren't that many even combinations. Let's leave 47.5 on the table. Let's see what this does. Oh, I used Ardeline. I'm gonna start over because that's not gonna work. Ardeline, we want to X her out. Okay, so these are like kind of like the key fighters that I have. Okay, and I was able to build 27 lineups like this, so I could use all of these. You know, how many total lineups are there? Let me just see something. There aren't even that many. You know, so. Regardless of how I rank these, we're going to get probably the same exposure of all these. So, Sim Diversity 10 or MMA Default, it's the same group. It's just a little different weighting of all these. So we probably should use MMA Default if we're going to play all this chalk, right? So let's put these in. Let's see if these have already been accounted for. Let's check this out. Save the favorites. 150, perfect. So then what you could do is again, you check your process. So what have we done? We built half the lineups with those really aggressive whatchamacallit, those really aggressive settings. We built another kind of like third of them with little less aggressive settings, but we've saved, you know, left money on the table. And then we built a couple of, you know, a handful of chalky builds with our kind of our best plays to balance out risk. The only thing that this has not done is built a portfolio, you know, because it does not. And building a portfolio means that, okay, if X happens in the portfolio, then it's going to affect the rest of the portfolio in this way. All we've really done is built, you know, 150 good lineups, right? Whether they work well together is much more difficult, okay? And that could be for a totally different whatchamacallit, totally different lecture. But those are some ideas. Again, you don't have to play this way, and you could you have, everybody has SaberSim has access to the same tools, and you guys can do your own experimentation and report back to what you know what seems to work for you. But that's what I'm probably going to do this week. Some variation of this, and obviously the projections will all change and all that stuff. But that'll do it. Should be a great card, and good luck.